So, this is going to be the first lecture in a sequence of lectures on the topic of operator algebras. We are going to go over the Catterson and Ringrose book, Fundamentals of the Theory of Operator Algebras, Volume 1, and possibly continuing on later to Volume 2. Now, the theory of operator algebras is a beautiful theory. It combines both techniques from analysis, looking at things called Hilbert spaces and functional calculus. And it involves elements of algebra. I mean, looking at a set of algebras. And really it gets its use in combining these two fields. A prerequisite for this class would probably be linear algebra and calculus. You should also have some real analysis and complex analysis to go with this. As I stated, we'll be using this textbook, and there will be a link in the description. Okay, we are going to start off by talking about linear spaces. So first, we're always going to be dealing with an underlying vector space over some scalar field K, which we'll write in the blackboard bold font. It is either going to be the complex numbers or the real numbers. If it's the reals, we'll specify the real or complex. Otherwise, we're just talking about either. Okay, so let V be a vector space. Now we'll always have V in this scripty symbol. So let X and Y be subsets of V, and A be an element of our scalar field. Then the set X plus Y is going to be all elements of the form X plus Y. Since they're in the same vector field, we can add them. X is an X, and Y is an Y. We're also going to have AX, so talking about scaling our set, is going to be the set A times X, where X is, as you probably guessed, an X. We're also going to want X minus Y. So we're going to want to use minus just like we use plus here. This can be X plus minus 1 Y, which is just going to be the set X plus Y, where X is an X, and Y is in minus 1 times Y. Since we're using minus this way, we also need to know how to denote set minus. We're going to use this forward slash as our set minus, where Y complement is the complement of Y. Okay, one last thing, just for nice syntax. Suppose X is a single element, then we will just say X plus Y instead of having some set x
plus y.
It just makes the syntax easier. Okay. Continue on. Suppose x1 through xn is a subset of x, and a1 through an is a subset or scalar field. Then we are going to denote by a finite linear combination. The sum of the xi's times the ai's. Right, so a finite linear combination of things in x is just a sum of finitely many elements of x times things in the scalar field. We can stretch these vectors as we so choose. Okay. So, if we have this set of x's, then we say, let's just denote this x0. X0 is linearly independent, so it's linearly dependent if for some set a1 through an in k, and some where at least one of these ans is not zero, we get the sum ai xi is the zero vector. Just a quick aside, sometimes people write a bar over the zero to denote a vector, or they might put a bar over the xi's. We're going to say zero for both the zero vector and the zero scalar. It should be obvious in context. If it's not, I'll call that. If this never happens, then x is linearly independent. X naught is linearly independent. A quick note, if all of these ai's are zero, then this sum must be zero. That's why we required this. Okay. So we are going to denote by the span of x often with the square brackets as the sum, as the set of all finite linear combinations of x. Now you notice everywhere we're dealing with finite, we don't want to deal with infinite sums. Things might diverge. You have analysis going on. We'll discuss later. This is a subspace. So a subspace, as you recall, a subset of V closed under finite linear combinations. Usually we're discussing subspaces or vector space because we really want to be able to add things in our set. We want to be able to scale things in our set. Okay. Now, let's get something very interesting. This should make sense to you if you've taken, say, a course in aspect algebra. Let V0 be subset of X, be a subspace. Well, just to know linear subspace. Then we are going to denote V mod V0 as the set V plus V0, where V is an element of V. First note, this is a set of sets. Okay. Now suppose we take two elements, X, Y, and V, and X plus V0 equals Y plus V0. Well, then we know we can subtract both sides, X minus Y plus V0 minus V0. In a vector space, addition is always commutative, so this is okay. Now, V0 minus V0. Well, we know that 0 is always an element of V. So this contains V0. And these elements are always in V0. So it's contained in V0. So this is if and only if X minus Y plus V0. This equals zero. And this is just V0. So, then we get x minus y must be an element of V0. Just to say this better. This tells us this to here. I'm going to subtract V0, I guess, to make this better. If x plus b0 equals y plus b0. I guess we'd better if we just subtracted y from both sides. I apologize. Because this is bringing you out, and this, so minus, is bringing you back. And since the only way to get from something outside of V0 to something plus something in V0 to V0, these must originally be in V0. My apologies. Okay. This will tell us that addition of these sets is actually well defined. More than that, if you remember from algebra, this is actually a group structure. But we can get more. Suppose we have our A in our scalar field. Then A times x plus V0, well, this, by definition, is the set x plus V, where V is in V0, times A. And this equals the set AX plus AV, do this lower, AX plus V, where V is in V0. This distributes AX plus AV, where V is in V0. Well, if A is not 0, then this is invertible. And so the set AV, where V is in V0, is the same thing as the set V, where V is in V0. So it equals AX plus V, which is just a X plus V0. Okay. If A equals 0, then we're just going to let this be 0 plus V0.
It's the zero vector in our group. And zero is an element of V0. So. With this, we actually get a nice vector space. So, this, as we see, given this and this, is a vector space over our scalars field. As a vector space, it has some dimension. We let the dimension, we call dim, of V mod V0 over K. We're going to define that to be the codimension. Of V0 in V. So oftentimes it's written COD V V0, or we'll say the codimension of V0 in V. Okay. Now we have. We will continue. So right now, really, we've been playing in our vector space, right? We've been scaling our vector space, and we've been thinking about, well, let's mod out by a subspace. But really, we want to talk about operators. So, suppose we have two vector spaces, V and W. Now, a linear operator usually denoted by an uppercase Roman letter. It's going to go from some vector space to the other vector space. It's a map from V to W, where if you take two elements in V, say x and y, and two scalars, a and b, then you get t ax plus by. So this is a finite sum of elements in a vector space. It's still an element of a vector space. Equals ATX plus BTY. Now, how did we get here? Well, really, we want to be able to do two things. First, we want to be able to take T of just A times X And we want to be able to take this out. My apologies. For this to work, right, this is a vector, and I'm saying take this scalar times this vector. So they must be over the same vector space. M2. If I'm taking the sum of two vectors, this should be equal to first doing the operator on each of the independent vectors and then taking the sum. So just to show these two are equal, if I have ax plus by, so if I'm doing t of this, well, 2, so let me distribute. This is a vector. This is a vector. Okay. And this, with 1, so this shows 1 and 2 is equivalent to this. To go the other way, suppose b is 0. So this is going this way. And now we want to go the other way. If b equals 0, then this tells me t ax plus 0 times y. Well, that's 0. Ax plus 0 is 0. So just t of ax. The other side, I still get atx. Right? But this is 0 times a vector. So 0. And so I get 1. Getting 2, if a equals b equals 1, well, 1 times x is x, and 1 times y is y. So t, x plus y, 1 times tx is tx, 1 times ty is ty. So these two are actually equivalent. Now, we want to talk about certain subspaces corresponding to this operator. The null space, as you recall from your linear algebra class, null of T is just the set X in our vector space where T of X equals 0. So the things that T kills. Always remember, this is a subspace of our original vector space. And the range of T is going to be the set T of X, where X is in V. So it's the things that we can get to by T. And this is always a subspace of a range space. Note, this might not be all of W, but it is a subspace. You probably learned this in linear algebra or abstract, but you should prove this. And this, the null space, is always a subspace. This is very important. Again, if you haven't seen the proof before, you should go and prove it. Okay. So, now, we're going to have a lemma. It's a very important lemma, but not. The most important lemma. So, let V0 be a linear subspace. Of V. Then, let Q be the map from V to V mod V0, it's going to take a vector x and send it x plus V0. Clearly, it's not one-to-one. It is injective. We want Q to be a linear operator. We kind of proved this earlier, but let's do it again. So, what will we have? We want, if we take Q of two elements in V, this should be Q of x plus Q. So we sum and then do Q should be the same as doing Q and taking the sum. I apologize, that's very hard to read. That's a little better. So, showing this, if we have x plus y, Q of x plus y, this is just going to be the set x plus y plus v0. Now, v0 plus v0 is v0, as we said earlier. With this, addition, commutative, let's not do that, is an equal x plus y plus v. It's more illustrative. So this is just the definition. instead of just taking this one V, I can do this right here will give me the same set as this. Because I can just take that to be 0, get the same set. And V plus V0, so V plus V prime is always in V0. Have to remember to avoid that white line in the future. Now, addition is commutative. So we move this V, we switch the Y and the V. I have to remember to shut off my screensaver. I can separate these two into x plus v, where v is in v0, y plus v. See what I did there? These two are the same. You can use basic set theory to prove this out. This is just x plus v0 plus y plus v0. Let's just put parentheses. And this is q of x. And this is q of y. Okay. Last thing we have to do is suppose A is an element of our scalar field. Now, look at Q of A times our set. This is by definition AX plus V0. AX plus V. V is in V0. Now, as long as we assume A is not 0, in which case we get into the case where dealing with a 0 with the zero element, in which case we should let B be the whole set, and zero is an element of V0 since V0 is a subspace. This is just that. And this is a Q of X. It is a little annoying that we have the special case of 0. But all can you do? You just define it to be what you want. And this finishes our lemma. Okay. Now, we're going to handle, we're going to look back to our operator T. Just some operator from one vector, some linear operator from one vector space to another vector space. We're going to suppose the null space of T is V0. X and Y are in V, and T of X equals T of Y, then we're going to get T, well, we subtract T of Y from both sides. T of X minus T of Y is 0. T is linear. This is if and only if T X minus Y equals 0. So X minus Y must be in V0. Okay. Then we can define T0 of X plus V0 just as T of X. T0 goes V mod E0 W. This statement here says this is well defined. It didn't matter what element X we took. Okay, so we can write T equal to T0 composed with Q. So for vector X, first we map X into V mod V0 with Q, and then we map it to W. We get this map. And this map commutes. If we do this, the same, it's going to Q, going to T0. We also say T factors through B mod B zero. Okay. We're gonna have two more things to note, then we'll finish. We'll discuss kind of where we're going in this class. And then what will be next time. Okay. Next. Suppose we're going to take two linear operators, T and S. They are both going to go from V to W. Then define as for X and Y in V, so for X and Y in V, and A and B in K, this is that. T plus AT plus BS of X and equal ATX plus BSX. Namely, this is going to take two operators times two elements of our scalar field and give us, well, this is an element in our range field, this is an element in our range field. So this is a map from V to W. We can multiply the element to our scalar field and add our operators. So this makes the set of linear operators from V to W into a vector space. We can do everything we wanted in the vector space with these operators. So right now, we gave kind of like the basic linear objects we're going to talk about. There's one more called a functional, which we'll usually denote by a lowercase Greek letter. If we can, rho. We might prefix it with linear. So a linear functional rho is a linear operator from our vector space into a scalar field. So it's just the same thing as any of these other linear operators. Just instead of going into some arbitrary vector space, we're actually going into our scalar field. Next time, we're going to discuss all of these. Well, we're going to discuss properties of linear functionals. And really, they make up one of the most important classes of objects in the theory of operator algebras. So I hope I've given a taste of kind of the algebraic side. This class, and really the next few, are going to discuss these algebraic functions. After a while, we'll discuss topological objects. And really, the power comes from having these algebraic elements and combining a topology. And that lets us prove lots of strong things. So section one kind of builds up the algebraic and topological requirements. Then we will go on to discuss Hilbert spaces and more properties of these algebras. And then we'll kind of restrict what we're looking at. That'll all be in time. I hope you found this interesting. And I hope you stay tuned for lecture 2.